Morning.
The Old Testament lesson this morning is from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 to 25, and it can be found on page 641 of your pew Bible. See, I will create new heavens and a new earth. The former things will not be remembered, nor will they come to mind. But be glad and rejoice forever in what I will create. For I will create Jerusalem to be a delight and its people a joy. I will rejoice over Jerusalem and take delight in my people. The sound of weeping and of crying will be heard in it no more. Never again will there be in it an infant who lives but a few days, or an old man who has not lived out his years. The one who dies at 100 will be thought a mere child. The one who fails to reach 100 will be considered accursed. They will build houses and dwell in them. They will plant vineyards and eat their fruit. No longer will they build houses and others live in them, or plant and others eat. For as the days of a tree, so will the days of my people. So will be the days of my people. My chosen ones will, excuse me, my chosen ones will long enjoy the work of their hands. They will not labor in vain, nor will they bear children doomed to misfortune, for they will be a people blessed by the Lord, they and their descendants with them. Before they call, I will answer. While they are still speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb will feed together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox, and dust will be the serpent's food. They will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 to 10, and that's found on page 987 of your pew Bible. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, because when we are clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed instead with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. Now the one who has fashioned us for this very purpose is God, who has given us the Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. Therefore, we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we live by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please Him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. The gospel is from John chapter 5, verses 25 to 29, and that can be found on page 908 of your pew Bible. Please rise if you are able. Very truly I tell you, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in Himself, so He has granted the Son also to have life in Himself. And He has given Him authority to judge because He is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this. For a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear His voice and come out. Those who have done what is good will rise to live. And those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. Here ends the readings.
Thank you.
I think we need to open with a word of prayer. I've got a message for you this morning that for some of you, it might be something you haven't heard. We'll see. If you've read the Word of God, we'll see how much of this seems different to you. But as I asked the deacons in the office, I said, I need your grace, God, for this one today. So let's pray. Father, we want to be stewards of your word, of the message that you've given us. We ask for understanding, even when your word speaks truths that in our flesh we cannot understand. So Holy Spirit, would you give us opening to receive, to hear, to understand, and to live out your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So a couple of weeks ago, we looked at sin as the core reason for there being so much trouble in the world. And that trouble manifested itself in so many ways, doesn't it? Through hardships and trials and pain and corruption and death. Then last week, we talked about what God has done in response to this core issue that has afflicted the entire creation. And we talked about how the Bible really is the story. It's the book God has given us of his dealing with his creation from beginning to end to guide us through this life while he's in the process of restoring all things to his original plan. But it is a process. We need to understand that. God has been at it for a long time, we could say, when we're talking in human terms. I mean, thousands and thousands of years. But I guess when we're talking from God's perspective, what does he say? 1,000 years is like a day. When you're dealing with an eternal perspective, it probably isn't really so long as God looks at it. You and I are on this earth in its present state for a very short period of time, aren't we? And those of you who have lived a few decades, you understand and would agree that this life really flies by. When you're a little kid, you don't believe that's true, but you get to be 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years old, and you realize it's like a breath, and it flies by. So the question I would pose to you this morning is this. Where is all this leading? I mean, what's next? We've got our ideas, our thoughts, our faith, but what's it going to look like as all of this transpires? What's it going to look like for the world, and what's it going to look like for us as individuals? Do you ever have those kind of questions in your mind? Have you ever wondered, too, where we are right now on the timeline of God's plan for his creation? Are we in the early stages? In the later stages of it? Are we somewhere in the middle of what God is doing? Now, obviously, God hasn't given us every specific detail of every question that we might have, but you know what? There is more in this book with regard to the detail of God answering those kind of questions than you and I might be aware of if we would take the time to seek it out. If you would take the time to really search this book, you will be amazed at how specifically God answers some of the questions we might have. So let's take a look, first of all, at I'm going to have us look at the end, the culmination of God's plan, and then we're going to broaden the lens a little bit to see some of what he's told us that we can expect along the way with regard to our eternal destiny as children of God. So the second to the last chapter in the book, Revelation chapter 21, verse 3 says this, I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. I mean, that's it, church. There it is, Redeemer, the end result of everything that God is in the process of accomplishing. He sets it out in that statement. I guess we back up from that culmination of things to today, present life, looking at history, and we say, well, why is God so involved with all of this? And really, the only answer that I can come up with from the scripture is why does God want to be so involved with all of these details and the moving forward of history. And by the way, it's not just haphazard. What comes will come. God is giving direction. It's a linear progression of history. It's going somewhere. Okay? It's not just by chance. It's not circular, as some belief systems would have you believe, that it just starts over and over and over and rewinds. It's linear. It's headed somewhere. Why is God so involved in all of this? And the answer is because he, in his heart, his greatest desire is to be with you personally. I mean, and I'm talking face to face here, like you're with your family, like you're with the people you're sitting by right now in your pew. God wants to be with you that way, that personally, forever. That's why he has taken it upon himself to be so involved in what happens in the history of this world. So I want to step back and look at this timeline, because it is going somewhere, as we said. And for the sake of laying out a framework for what God is doing, I'm going to suggest four different, I'll just call them ages, to Earth's existence. And I'm going to just admit up front, this is my categorization. This isn't some scientific thing laid out here. So I'm not referring to science here. I'm just using the term ages and suggesting four of them according to how I'm reading Scripture. And I'm not referring even to the length when I say the ages. I'm referring to a period of time, whatever it might be. And I'm using that term kind of like in the same manner that Paul used it in his second letter to Timothy when he says this, and I'm quoting from ESV, New American Standard, your pew Bible says it a little differently, but it says, "The purpose and the grace of God," he's talking about, "which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began." I think in your New American Standard it says, "which he gave us in Christ Jesus from all eternity." But literally, to break that down, it says, "before the ages," plural, "began." Two of those ages of which I'm referring to this morning have already come into being. I'm talking about four. Two have come into being, and then two are yet to come. The first age of the earth, I personally believe, was a very short age. And I'll call it just the original earth, as God originally created it. This was the earth as he created it and was in a condition which God called what? He created it and it was good. That was the original way in which it was created. It was the time before sin entered into this creation and corrupted everything that God had once declared good. It was different in this original earth age, most notably, I guess we could say, by the absence of sin, but it was also different in a lot of physical aspects. Do you know that? This was before the worldwide flood, wasn't it? Which was a result of sin. All the waters from beneath the surface of the earth sprang up, and at the same time, there had been God, the way he created the earth, according to Scripture, was a canopy surrounding the earth, which held waters above the heavens, within the heavens, which released a dew to water the earth. It didn't have storms of rain like we do now, but he released from under the earth and above the earth all at the same time just a deluge which flooded the earth and changed everything, physically speaking. So all the land masses were completely different before the flood than they are after the flood. Now, there was a period of time, hundreds of years, in fact, between the entrance of sin into the creation and the flood. And that's why I say the original earth in its sinless state was probably a very short period of time. We know Adam lived hundreds of years physically after he died spiritually, right? And I know this maybe flies in the face of many who believe that there were millions or billions of years of prehistory before mankind ever came onto the scene. But for reasons that we discussed a week ago, related to the fact that God said that death came into the creation through one man's sin, I can't personally subscribe to the millions and billions of years idea. And please don't interpret my comments to mean that I think you're not a Christian if you don't hold to the same position as I do on this. God doesn't offer salvation on the basis of perfect understanding of His Word in all matters. He offers salvation on the basis of faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. And personally, I don't think there's a human being who's ever lived, who's ever completely understood everything that God has declared perfectly and accurately in his own heart and mind. And we can be thankful for that. It's on faith in Jesus Christ. But neither, then, should we use our limitations, our inabilities to understand everything about God as an excuse for not searching out and studying the things that God has said in His Word. God doesn't want us to make those excuses. If God didn't want us to know what His plan is for creation and for us beyond this present age, He wouldn't have included so much of the information that He's put into this book. It's there because He wants you to know. I want to look secondly now, the second age of the earth. And this is the age that I'm saying is the present age in which we're living. The age in which the creation, including humanity, is under the curse of sin. In my understanding of Scripture, this has been by far, the longer of the two ages that I'm referring to, in which the earth has existed, because, as we know, sin entered into the creation through the first human beings. And from then on, up until now, sin remains in this creation. It was into this present age in which you and I are living that God intervened, didn't He? By sending His Son, Jesus, to cancel the power of sin by laying down His innocent life in place of our guilt. And because of that act of grace at Calvary, even though sin still reigns in this age of the world, it no longer reigns over the lives of those who have accepted God's gift of grace in Jesus. So sin doesn't rule over you like it once would have, even though you still battle the effect of sin in the world. So that much has changed, but you know, there is much greater change coming. Do you know that, according to what the Word of God says? And those changes will lead us into the third and fourth ages of the earth, both of which, as we said earlier, are future ages. So the third age, as I understand Scripture, will be what Scripture calls a millennial age. And I know there are different interpretations of this, and I'm just going to give you where I'm at, and I've looked into it more and more as the years have gone by. Not that I understand things either, but it makes sense, and I believe this is what God is doing here in the earth and in His plan to bring about His original purpose. As we look into these coming ages, and I'm going to notify you now what we're going to talk about, as I did a bit ago, they're going to seem strange to some of you because Scripture describes some things that are very different from everything we've come to know as normal in our lives. But I want you to open your ears and your heart to what God has told us about the coming ages. And I have this question. Or maybe this is a question that you should have on your heart as you look into this. What is God in the process of bringing about? And what is the destination toward which all of this is moving? I mean, these are important questions, and we can go on in life and push them aside, and yet it doesn't stop what God is doing. Scripture describes the millennial age as the age during which Jesus Christ will physically reign over all the earth from a human throne in the physical city of Jerusalem. You wonder why there's so much focus on Jerusalem. There's a real spiritual thing going on here, church. And there's an incredible amount of information in the Scriptures about what this age is going to be like. Jim just read a passage from Isaiah 65. Did you catch it? Did you hear what was said about this age? I mean, if you don't live to be 100 years old, you're going to be cursed, considered to be cursed. There's going to still be death, so that's not, we're not talking about heaven here. We're talking about some major changes, though. Isaiah 9, another passage that you consider probably a Christmas passage, and yet have you ever thought about what it really says here? Because sometimes prophecies speak of the coming of Jesus the first time and the second time in the same sentence. It just kind of consolidates it all. Listen to what you know very well and think about what this means, Isaiah 9. The government will be on his, Jesus' shoulders. Well, they tried to put the government on his shoulders when he came 2,000 years ago, and he said, no, it's not time. But Isaiah says the government will be on his shoulders, and of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. I mean, this is talking about Jesus on the earth. It hasn't happened that way yet. There are some big changes coming, church. Zechariah 14, verse 9 says, the Lord will be king over all the earth. Verse 16 said, listen to this. Everyone who survives of all the nations that have come against Jerusalem, and there's a lot in the scripture about the nations of the earth under the evil one trying to wipe out Jerusalem. And my personal understanding and belief of that is because the devil knows that Jesus made a promise that involves Jerusalem. And if Jerusalem isn't there, then Jesus is going to be a liar because he can't fulfill his promise. And I think that's at the core of why Jerusalem is so much in the crosshairs of so much hatred and evil in the world. But it says, everyone who survives of all the nations that have come against Jerusalem, that's still future, we might call it Armageddon, shall go up year after year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, to keep the Feast of Booths. And if any of the families of the earth do not go up to Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, there will be no rain on them. Psalm 66, listen to this. It describes what will be going on in the earth when Christ is ruling from Jerusalem. Verse 3 says, because of the greatness of your power, your enemies, in other words, there are still unsaved people in the earth when Jesus is reigning from Jerusalem, because of the greatness of your power, your enemies will give feigned obedience to you. Well, there's an interesting concept, isn't it? There are going to be people who will do what Jesus says because of the greatness of his power, because they know that if they don't, things aren't going to go well for them. Not because they love him, not because they trust in him. It won't be coming from the heart. I mean, for most it will, but not for all. And it explains how, according to Revelation 20, verses 7 to 9, when this age comes to an end, the devil, when he's released from his prison for a short time, will have the ability to gather a following of the armies of the nations to come against this king in Jerusalem to try to dethrone him, because they never gave their heart's allegiance to him in the first place, so many. And we know how successful the devil can be in tempting people to turn away from him. If he can convince people that, you know, this one's not insurmountable, he's not somebody that we can't overthrow, and the nations are going to think, again, in delusionary power, you know, if we all come together, we can get rid of this guy and have things the way the world was before he showed up. That's going to happen. Overall, it will be a 1,000-year period of time in which righteousness will go forth from Jerusalem. And the curse of sin, though not removed, will be curtailed in the earth in its influence. This is the age immediately following Christ's return in power and glory, and at which time he rescues Israel from all the nations which will be on the brink of annihilating her. I mean, you've just been hearing in the United Nations reports this last week, they've just voted that Jerusalem has no historical ties to the Jews. Did you realize that? Jerusalem has no ties to the Jews, and every reference to Jerusalem they're now putting in Islamic terms. United Nations. I mean, this thing is happening. You wonder where we are in the timeline of all this. I think we're further along than a lot of people would like to believe. As for you and me and all believers, it gets stranger, folks. Scripture says we'll be reigning with Christ on the earth in glorified bodies, because when he returns, you meet him in the air, and in a twinkling of an eye, you are changed. You change from this mortal to immortality in the twinkling of an eye, and you return with Christ to the earth for that period. You reign with him. All of his saints, the implication is, will be assigned different roles of responsibility amongst the nations of the earth. It'll be an age for us right now that is almost incomprehensible because of how different everything will be. Jesus in Jerusalem, the saints in their eternal glorified bodies, and yet the earth being repopulated over this period of time by those who survived the tribulation but were not children of God at the time, and therefore not part of what Revelation 20 verse 5 calls the first resurrection when Jesus returns. If you look in Revelation 25, it says, blessed are those who are a part of the first resurrection. The rest, when they die, their resurrection doesn't come until the end of the 1,000 years. Things are going to change someday. I mean, there will be people still in their fleshly bodies as we currently are, and yet there will be people reigning with Christ in immortality. How do you define that? How do you describe that? How do we think about that? But that's not the final age. The final age, the eternal age, follows this millennia. And once again, we have to keep in mind, what is God's desire? Remember, we looked at the end first in Revelation, the second to the last chapter, to dwell personally with the people he created, as he did for a short time, even with Adam and Eve. The Bible says they walked with God in the garden. I mean, God wants that again. That's what he's bringing back. And as King of Kings and Lord of Lords and as ruler of the earth from Jerusalem for 1,000 years, Jesus, I believe, will be in a state of the increase of his government, of peace, there'll be no end. He'll be in a process of preparing the earth for the coming of his Father in fullness of glory and power upon this creation to dwell with man. I mean, we think of heaven as being whisked off to someplace unknown forever and ever. I don't think that's the case. I think now when people die that know the Lord, they're with him. And he doesn't tell us where that is. It's a different realm, a different reality. I mean, his ultimate goal is not to throw away this creation, but to make it what he intended it in the beginning and to live here with his creation. He's in the process of restoring all of that plan. Remember Revelation 21, behold, John says. In other words, look. He sees it in a vision. Look at what I'm seeing. The dwelling place of God is with man. That's something to declare because it's so unheard of, so unknown. But that's where God is taking this world. That's what he's in the process of doing. But it is a long process from our perspective. 2,000 years ago, he canceled the power of sin to condemn you for eternity. He canceled it. Colossians 2:14, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, everything we've ever done, which was hostile to us, it would have condemned us forever, he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. So, question, why didn't God just wrap it up then, after he had already paid the debt, after he had taken sin's power away from you? Away from the devil. I mean, the devil was defeated. Why not move the creation then right into the eternal age? Answer? Because he's building a kingdom. God is in the process of building a kingdom, and he's filling it with people because he loves people. The news of what he did, which we call the gospel, needs to reach to the ends of the earth so that all nations have the opportunity to be a part of something incredibly designed and incredibly carried out by God, and that requires time in human terms. Peter wrote in 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord isn't slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but he's patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. So church, as each age of the earth comes to an end and transitions into the next age. There are major, major changes that accompany that transition. The Bible uses a term, childbirth, to describe what those transitions are like. The hardship, the pain of moving into a new age. You see, between the original age and the present age of the earth, God changed the earth's atmosphere, didn't he? He changed the land formations. He resituated the boundaries of the land and the seas. And all of this by means of a worldwide flood. The next major change that will affect the whole earth won't happen by means of a flood, because God promised he would never do that again. You know what's going to initiate it in, the most major of the changes? A devastating earthwide or worldwide earthquake, among other catastrophic events. There'll be numerous earthquakes according to the scripture in various places leading up to the end, but the quake that will change the earth will happen at the very end of the age, as God is ushering the earth into the millennial age. And there's a description of it in Revelation 16, beginning at verse 17. It says, "The seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and a loud voice came out of the temple from the throne, saying, 'It is done.' And there were flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder and a great earthquake such as there had never been since man was on earth. So great was that earthquake. The great city was split into three parts." Remember, this is vision, looking forward. "Into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell. And God remembered Babylon the Great," not in a good way, not in a favorable way, "to make her drain the cup of the wine of the fury of his wrath. And every island fled away, and no mountains were to be found." So between the first and the second age of flood, between the second and the third age to come, an earthquake. But neither of these events compares to the final change that will impact the earth. And this is a change that will usher in the eternal age when God dwells with man forever, I believe, on this earth. The most graphic description of it, again, recorded by Peter. 2 Peter 3:10, "The heavens will pass away with a roar. The heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are in it will be exposed." That's ESV. NASB has a footnote. Some of them say will be burned up, but that's not the literal translation. NASB has a footnote that says they will be discovered. In other words, that which is holding back what their true intent is will be taken out of the way through this fire. Do you remember how Paul wrote about every person's works will go through fire? In 1 Corinthians 3, it says each one's works will be manifest, will be exposed, will be discovered, for the day will disclose it. That's talking about the day entering into the eternal age. "Because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation, Jesus, survives, he'll receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he'll suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire." So when Peter writes about the earth going through this fire, some teach that Peter's teaching of a total destruction of this earth. I don't think that's consistent through all of the other scriptures where God tells us something different. What will be destroyed in that fire is anything that is not connected to God's kingdom, anything that belongs to this world rather than to heaven. And in the same way that our present bodies will be destroyed, the earth will be destroyed, not unto annihilation, but unto restoration. The very body that you're sitting in right now, this hour, in this room, will be your body for eternity. But it's going to be changed, upgraded significantly. Okay? "This mortal must put on immortality." But it's your body that you're sitting in right now that will put on immortality. That's almost incomprehensible, isn't it? "This present earth will also put on immortality." It's the biggest change of all that this earth will ever go through. And I believe this is what Paul is referring to in Ephesians 1:10 when he speaks of, and I quote, "a plan for the fullness of time," in other words, when we arrive to the final age, "to unite all things in him," in Jesus, "things in heaven and things on earth." It describes the New Jerusalem descending to the earth out of wherever heaven is now, from which Christ will forever reign with his people. And once God brings this world through the fire, it is purified. It's made eternal, and it is fit for God to live in it with us. That's what God has wanted from the beginning, isn't it? And Satan did his best to mess it up, and many lives will be lost for eternity because of what he did, sadly. But God never gave up on his plan. And the best news is, he hasn't nor ever will give up on you. That's how much he loves you. Amen.
His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms